Something's coming through. Something's coming. Never really arrive. Never really arrive. But every increment of the way, as you continue to do it, and through the years, your techniques are more refined. Your ability to speak the energy is more acute, maybe more sharpened, more honed. And so, the more you can, on the one hand, get out of the way. Get out of the way. Get out. Get out of the way. 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 Get out. Get out of the way. Can you see it? Can you hear it? Can you feel it? How'd you do that? The breath. The breath. Something, 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 something else is something else is something is moving us. Something else. Something Something out. Unveiling the mystery. The mystery. Unveiling the mystery in us. Unveiling the mystery in us. Can you see it? Can you feel it? Can you hear it? Rituals, and dreams. Rituals and dreams. Find the thing that's there. The visitation. Ride. The trance. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. It's my understanding that the five artists here tonight have played together and apart in different ensembles, but never together in this combination. And they came together in this combination through an invitation to participate in a research project that has been guided by a central question about what we in the field of education and learning sciences can learn about human development and maturation from artists and the work
Thank you.
I think so.
It's just true.
Okay. Well, thank you for coming back, everyone. As I had mentioned before, this is this performance is connected to a research project that was generously funded by the Spencer Foundation. And it's really been motivated by two guiding questions. How do artists who routinely collaborate and improvise understand the development of their skills, knowledge, and capacities across time, space, and social relationships? And how can these artists' conceptual, spatial, and relational practices help the fields of learning sciences and education reimagine the design and organization of learning environments around principles of relationality? And as a researcher, I've spent a lot of time studying how people routinely coordinate attention and observation with the hope of finding some guiding principles to take them back to the design of educational spaces so that young people can thrive. And I've also spent a lot of my life watching my father and his friends perform, and so I knew that what musicians and artists do to organize their attention and observation is different than what we expect of young people in classrooms. And I thought that we have something to learn from what artists are doing. And I invited everybody to participate in this project with me. And thankfully for me, they said yes. And we're joined today by Fred Jackson. And part of why we asked Fred to join us is because I can bring the language of education, but I don't necessarily bring the deep history and language of music. And so we wanted somebody to partner in this conversation and have different and multiple perspectives. So Fred, I think, is going to offer some reflections, maybe, and pose a question.
Very shortly. Okay. I want to say I'm very honored to be here, and thank you for having me. I really enjoyed the set. It was very, I was on a trajectory. I was traveling a little bit with you guys. So I appreciate that experience. So I'm under understanding that we are short on time for some of us. So we should probably just jump right into our origin question. So I'm going to pass the ball around, so to speak, to have everyone give their origin story. We're going to give them like 2 minutes or so to speak. And just so just so we can stay on time, I'm going to pull out my little timer here. So, well, for our origin stories, my order would have been Ms. Zahra Baker, and then it would have been Ms. Lisa Abrams, then Joshua Abrams, then Mr. Michael Zeranga, and Mr. Hamid Drake. But we're going to switch things around a little bit. Me and Ms. Abrams was speaking just a few minutes ago about the importance of school.
Alvarado. Yeah, that's my last name.
Oh, Alvarado, I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's okay.
I'm sorry. Okay, so Alvarado. So Ms. Alvarado, we will start with you.
Okay. Yes, I need to get home because my daughter needs to wake up early, so I apologize. I'm only here for a little while, but I'm honored to be a part of this group. And as an origin story, I'm actually from San Antonio, Texas. And I'm of Mexican-American descent, and I'm a visual artist. Joshua brought me into music, and it's a beautiful life here with these people in the community.
Oh, awesome. So you're from Houston, Texas?
San Antonio,
Texas.
Yeah, South Texas.
Okay, so you are somewhat of a... I'm from Fort Worth originally.
Oh,
so
really?
Yeah. So you said, yeah, you're kind of like a homegirl right there. Okay. All right. So that's beautiful.
Fort Worth, wow.
So what brought you into music, and what was one of your first inspirations that got you?
Oh God, just hearing music from my parents and going to weddings and like family events with my family, just seeing like live music and the Hano groups and a lot of dancing that went along with that. I guess I was really into dancing.
Okay.
And it just grew from there. Music always gave me motivation and just like brought me out of whatever feeling I was in. If I was feeling down or maybe uninspired, putting on music was always like an answer for me to get into a different space or feel more like myself or just like conquer whatever emotion was holding me back from really enjoying it, the experience I was having or getting to that place that I wanted to be in. Especially in working as a visual artist, I always had to have some music on.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Nice. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
That was going to be my next question. You know, that's awesome. Okay. Miss Baker.
Hello.
Hi. How are you? You over there working really hard? Okay. Yeah. So I will pose the same. First, we want to hear your origin story.
My origin
story. So give you
story.
Some time for that.
I come from the stars.
Yeah.
They say I was born in Louisiana, but I remember the stars.
You remember the stars.
Yeah. But music is the place that I call home. There was a lot of challenges in my early childhood, and when I heard the songs that my grandmother sang halfway around the country, it took me right back to the senses and the smells and the comfort and the nurturing that I had gotten from her. And that became my place of solace. And that's where I live. That's where I want to live. So.
You know, I noticed, I think we spoke on another occasion about you being from Louisiana.
Mm-hmm.
And my family is from Louisiana too, so we have some kind of connection in that way. So I notice a lot when you're singing, like it's very soulful, and I want to say bluesy, but definitely soulful. Could you expound on that, like what you're feeling when you go into your singing?
Well, that's funny. That's in one of our conversations. If you opened up the app, there are all these quotes and comments and things that we said, and one of them is it music or spirituality? And that's what it's. It's both. It's just the vibration that moves through me. That's all I can say. That's mm-hmm. where it becomes. I feel like it's my grandmother. You know,
I got
that's
you.
Coming through.
Probably so.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you. Mr. Abrams, I'm going to pose the same question to you. We need an origin story, so.
I moved to Chicago in around 1991 to go to school from the Philadelphia area, Jewish American, and I studied music some in school, but Chicago was more my real schooling in a way. And there was a point with it where it was like, you need to trust the music, and that will show you the way forward. So that's kind of that served me well, I guess. That's gotten me here.
1991.
That's when I moved here. Yeah.
Okay. So, for you, I wanted to ask you, like, what was one of your first influences on the bass? Was bass your first instrument?
Bass was, yeah.
Okay. Well, who were some of your first influences? Like, that really turned you on when you heard it, and it's like, I want to do that.
Right.
Yeah.
So I started playing bass, like everyone was gonna, if you wanted to do music, you might get, you know, be assigned a different instrument. And at the time I was kind of tall for my age, which didn't last. And everyone wanted to play the drums and I couldn't get a sound out of the trumpets. You play bass. I was like, okay. You know, and so a while I kind of, you know, I did it, but I didn't. And then I kind of found my way in through getting into rock and roll and stuff, and like into classic rock, like Jimi Hendrix and Led Zeppelin and things like this. But then I found my way back to the acoustic bass through hearing John Coltrane's music. Mm. And so Jimmy Garrison was like, that sound, you know, that was like a really early inspiration, and also some of Thelonious Monk's music, Wilbur Ware.
Mm-hmm.
There was a recording with Ahmed Abdul-Malik too, that was like that particular recording, I always loved that. So those concepts of the acoustic instrument were like early influences of what I was like, oh yeah, that what made sense saying to me. Yeah, that inspired me to keep trying to learn the instrument, and figure out how to get something like that sound, the sound, the power of that sound, even if it's finding your own sound, but just the force of that sound. Yeah.
Got it. I understand that. Okay. Thank you. Mr.
Thank
Zerang.
You.
Thank you. Yes. Same thing for you.
Origin story?
Yes, sir.
Well, I was born here in Chicago. My mother's family came from Baghdad, Iraq, in the mid-50s. And my father came by himself from Iraq in the mid-50s, although he was born in Iran, where they're all Assyrian descent. They moved to Chicago, and I was born shortly after. I had, for the first 4 or 5 years of my life, I stayed with my big, large, loving family. So I could have been being raised in Iraq until I was like 4 or 5 and I went outside for the first time and I realized this was not Iraq. So it was a bit of a culture shock, you know, coming into this. I showed up at kindergarten, I couldn't speak English. And by the time I was in first grade, I could speak English like the rest of the kids, but it still put me into this place of like, oh my goodness, I am an outsider here. This is not, and forever after that, I've always had that sort of underlying feeling. But my father, and I have to give him a lot of credit because he is a great music aficionado, and he was from the time he was a kid. So he brought not only a wealth of music with him when he came at age 18 to the United States, of a pan Middle Eastern music, Armenian, Turkish, Assyrian, Arabic, Kurdish, the whole spectrum. He was a fan. And then he also loved Louis Armstrong. He was going to come to the United States, and that's who he knew, Louis Armstrong. So he had all these Louis Armstrong records. So when we were growing up, I was the first one born here. I have three younger brothers. And so we were exposed to this all the time. And he also played the darbuka like I do, but as an amateur, he never picked it up to be a professional musician, but it was something that we played around the house all the time. We had tambourines lying around, so it was always just something you do at home with your family. It wasn't we're going to go have a performance. But my third brother Ziggy, who introduced me to Hamid, thank you for your lovely work too. See you. My brother Ziggy is the third in the four of us, and he introduced me to Hamid. And he was a musical prodigy of the family, let's say. When he was 2 years old, he started plunking on the piano. And by the time he was 7, he was playing a Farfisa duo compact that was modified by an electrician to play quarter tones. This is like 1970. In belly dancing nightclubs for belly dancers, playing all this Arabic music. So he was like this whiz kid. And so when I was a kid, we would just listen to him. My father played the drum. I had no notion of being a musician. But then also just in my life in Chicago, and it was a rough time when I finally, you know, and when I finally got out of the house, from the time I was 5 till the time I was about 16, it was a rough area I lived in, where I still live, up in Edgewater. And so music was a refuge, of course, any kind of music, listening to the rock and roll. And I was very fortunate to have people in my life just show up. Like when I was 13 or 14 years old, this kid named Eric Schuster, who's still my dear friend, he lived right up the street. And he had this massive jazz record collection. And his father was into jazz as well. So I would go over there and he would just play me everything. And I was completely, you know, it was all new to me. But I heard so much music when I was a kid that was, this is great music. But the thing that brought me to music, I'm trying to stay under 2 minutes. This could go on forever.
I got you. Don't worry.
The thing that really brought me to music, when I finished high school, I was 16 and a half or so, I hitchhiked to San Francisco, and I was on a four-month, they call it Vision Quest these days. At the time, I didn't know that it was a Vision Quest, but in fact, it was a Vision Quest. And my first stop was San Francisco, and I saw a concert of Roxanne Rolland-Kirk at the Keystone Corners in 1976, which is the place was, you know, apparently that was like Roxanne Rolland-Kirk's home base kind of club. He'd play there all the time. He was from the area for years. So it was like his home court. Mm-hmm. And I walked in there, 16 years old, 17 years old, whatever it was, and that was it. I didn't know what he was doing. I didn't know. All I knew that there was this amazing energy he was producing that was sort of purifying and was going through my whole system. And I often say that I felt like that moment had changed my DNA, or at least it aligned it, because I literally walked out of there thinking that's what I want to do, but not sure what it was, because I didn't necessarily want to play the saxophone and have a, you know, I knew it had something to do with music, of course, but past that, I knew that the only way to get to what I was experiencing was not necessarily with, initially anyway, with musical knowledge, but with just vibrational and energetic awareness.
You knew where you belonged at that point.
Well, yeah, it changed me.
Right.
So I was attuned to all of a sudden something different.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they called him a gimmick when he was alive and playing. A lot of people did that. And that was no gimmick. He was the real deal. All three saxophones, whistles, bells, radio, you know.
Wow.
Yeah. And you know, the thing is, it's so interesting to me. I've often talked about this. That night I sat there, it was just a kid, and I walked in with my buddy, we were hitchhiking, we sat there, we listened to two sets, and it changed my life completely. And the people sitting around me, I'm sure they had a good time. I'm sure it was a fantastic date night. I'm sure some people were really into it. But, you know, how does that happen? And that's also the first lesson I learned was about live music and about live performance and about anything that we do really in a communal setting. It has the potential to be transformative.
Yeah.
Not just, oh, I like that. Oh, I was grooving out to that, or, you know, whatever. It can change someone's life. So I take this playing of music very seriously, maybe too seriously, but it's something that I've tried to dedicate every moment that I can to trying to figure out what it is, trying to go further with it, trying to develop my techniques, trying to develop my mind. I'm so fortunate to work with amazing artists. So that's probably more than 2 minutes, but that's
That was good. You had a flow going, so we let you go ahead.
Well, the flow could go a lot longer, too.
Beautiful. Thank you. Beautiful. Mr. Drake. I want to take us to the beginning. Now, give us an origin story. You know, I know we talk, so we have some. It's interesting. Louisiana, everywhere.
Well, like Zahra, I was born in Louisiana, also Monroe, Louisiana. When I was very young, I was adopted by my aunt and uncle. My adopted mother, Amelia, was the sister of my biological mother, Etta. So Amelia wasn't able to have children, but my mother, Etta, she had already had four kids, and so they worked out a situation where Amelia would raise me. And so we came up to Chicago. So I was raised in the Chicago area. Music, for me also, music was always like, kind of like Michael and everybody here, it was always in the home, you know. But also, I had the good fortune of my family and the great saxophone player Fred Anderson. Our families actually lived together at one time, and you know, I was a kid, but I would hear Fred practicing in the basement all the time, and he'd come home from work. He was working at the Orientin Hotel in Evanston at the time, and when he would come home, he'd go straight down into the basement and start practicing. And then on the weekends, different musicians would come, and they would, you know, practice. And this was during the time of the early formation of an organization that was founded here in Chicago called the AACM, the Association for the Advancement of Creative Musicians. And many of those early members would come to Fred's home, where we were living also in practice. But me personally, I didn't start playing music until I think it was fifth grade, and I was asked to join the stage band, you know, in grade school. And I've told this story many times. The instrument that I really wanted to play was the trombone. You know, I didn't want to have anything to do with drums per se. You know. But I hated the drums. You know. So I felt, you know, the drummers were always in the back, kind of, you know, and. I felt that people didn't pay much attention to them. But
so trombone?
Trombone right up front.
Right.
But the band director, he said, because at that time, you know, kids were given instruments to take home and practice.
Right.
So there weren't any trombones left. So if I was going to be in the stage band, I had to play the snare drum and the big orchestral bass drum with another kid. And I begrudgingly did it, you know. And fortunately, the drum instructor at the school, he was very smart in a way, because he knew I didn't want to be there, you know. And so he was teaching me the rudiments and stuff like that. And then one day, he came in and he wrote out this rhythm for me to play, you know. And first he played it. I said, huh, you know. And then he asked me to play it. And the rhythm was the standard basic rock and roll rhythm. And it's a and when I heard it and when I did it, everything changed for me. You know, and then it's like I was like, oh wow, this is cool, you know. And so that's how my journey with drumming and playing music began. But I would say that the thing that really convinced me, an event that really convinced me, similar to Michael's, in that I really wanted to be a musician and how I wanted to make that my life, was when I was 16 years old, I met Alice Coltrane. Mm-hmm. And she was playing at Ravinia Park, which is it was a performance space, you know, north of Chicago, in the northern suburbs. And I went with friends and we went to see her. I'd listened to her music a little bit by that time, but when I met her, Michael was talking about transformative. That was a very transformative, spiritually transformative experience for me, meeting Turiya Aparna Sangeetananda, Alice Coltrane, and was able to go up on stage and talk to her, you know, shake her hand. She gave me a hug, and I was working at a place at that time called the Baha'i Temple, Baha'i House of Worship, and I was a practicing Baha'i then, so I had a Baha'i prayer book, and I had her sign it, and also I gave her a few Baha'i books And then on her next recording that came out, it's called Universal Consciousness, there was a quote from one of the books that I'd given her. You know? And but I think she was probably the one who really instilled in me. It's like she gave me something. She transmitted something to me that helped me to realize that the music was going to be a path for me, you know, and that playing music can be, or the arts in general, but speaking about music, can be a doorway to a greater type of understanding, and particularly regarding yourself, and that music carries a vibration that what we've been saying can be very transformative. And just meeting her transformed me, you know, into like wanting to do this. And just experiencing how music affects people, you know, on a cellular level, you know. And then that caused me to study other traditions in music, particularly music from India. Mm-hmm. You know, I had, at age 17, I started studying tabla with this man named Raman Papaya. But here he went by the name of Paul Raman because it's difficult for people to say Papaya. And he was very good friends with one of Shantanurla's teachers, you know, Patrick Marks. And Shanta, she's a great sitarist. And so that was another avenue for me to get deeper into the depths of the transformative experience of music. Because in Indian music, they have a concept called Nada Brahma, which means God is sound, or the divine is sound. Mm. And that sound, that vibration, can transform or alter anything, you know. And so I began studying the, I'll say more, the spirituality of music, especially through the writings of a great Sufi master by the name of Hazrat Inayat Khan.
Mysticism music.
Mysticism music. Mysticism of sound.
Mm-hmm. That's a great book.
And that totally turned me out, you know.
Yeah.
But also I've been fortunate to, like we've been saying, to come in contact with wonderful artists, you know, in all the different artistic worlds. And living here in Chicago couldn't have been a greater blessing for me. Meeting so many musicians, Michael, Joshua, Zahra, Fred Anderson, you know, Joseph John, and Steve McCall, Amina Claudine Myers. I mean, there's so many. Shanta, you know, so many, many, many musicians here that are on a path of service, you might say, because they know that, I mean, they serve the music, and they know that the music can serve, you know, others. So it's been a profession for me, but also it's been like a way of life, you know, a way of thinking, a way of getting to know yourself on deeper levels, a way of confronting your insecurities and vulnerability also, because there was a time for me, you know, I used to play like this, you know, and I couldn't look out, you know, into like the audience, you might say, and I would always get really super nervous before I would play. Musicians, well, men musicians normally didn't really talk about that, you know, and I would say, man, how are you feeling? They said, oh, man, I'm great. But I could tell something was happening inside, you know, and then fortunately I was given this book called The Courage to Create by the psychologist called by the name of Rollo May, and he talked about that particular experience that anyone who does anything creative, you're going to experience it in a biochemical way. You know, we call it butterflies, you know. But then when the mind takes over, it becomes like a fear. But that initial feeling is natural, you know.
Right.
And then later for me what happened, once I understood that, that gave me a little bit of an assurance. And later what started to happen with me was when I didn't feel that, that's when I would start to get worried. Because
right.
I would feel like my head was getting too big, you know. My ego was getting too, you know, too big. So I think music like Ananda was talking about education, you know, and I think music is probably one of the greatest educational vehicles that humanity, you know, has at its disposal. Music and the arts in general. You know.
So speaking of Ananda and education, I believe Dr. Marin.
I'm about
for
teaching
and
learning.
We've been having these Zoom meetings, you know, with Ananda.
Yeah, they've been very patient with me. And I ask a question, and they kind of laugh at me. They're like, what is she asking us? So I'm going to ask a question. I'm going to leave it out there for you all to respond to. This question actually came to me when I was walking, because I didn't know really, what do I want to ask him? What do I want to ask him? And I went on a walk. Actually, I need to also give thanks to two people that are in the audience, Lindsay Lindberg and Brenda. Who are graduate students at UCLA and have been doing a lot of work behind the scenes. And Brenda said to me, why don't you go for a walk? So I went on a walk, and the question that came to me was, what did you learn about each other in the moment-to-moment of this evening's performance? And see, they're laughing already. How did you learn this? And then how, if at all, did you shift the way you were performing in relation to what you learned? But I want to change the question, because I was having a conversation with Joshua and Lisa over here, and we were talking about Lisa's painting. And Joshua, you said that this was more like an activity in a way, and less like a performance.
What I found, I really appreciated. Well, first of all, I don't know if you know, this is the first time that Lisa's ever, I guess, painted on stage. I don't know if Zahra, if you've done this before. Yeah. Though at the same time, in our home, she would often paint while I played, or while different musicians would come over, record or just rehearse. So on one hand, it was really new, and then on the other hand, it was really familiar. And I thought it just broke down the performative aspect of it. So then all of a sudden we're all working on our tasks together and individually. And yeah, it's presentational, but it's also not. It's just we're all able to just do what we need to do. Zahra and Lisa's activity for me kind of fulfilled that too. And so it was interesting just seeing how it expanded what we've done a lot, but it just changed it all too. It was cool.
Yeah. So I wanted to shift the question a little bit to ask, what did you learn about yourself during this activity? And how did that lead you to perhaps shift in how you were collaborating with one another?
I can say something about how we, okay. For me, it was about things change, you know, mm-hmm. and stepping back. Because when we were doing our sound check, Lisa and Zahra were doing this beautiful harmonium and vocal piece together. You know? And so when we went back before we started to play, I was like, yeah. I had it in my mind that would be a beautiful way to start. And Zahra said, no, I don't want to start that way. And Lisa said, I don't want to start that way either. We want you guys to start with what you're doing with the gimbring and the frame drums, you know? And so it's about, we have to learn how, for me, one of the greatest lessons I learned about music and tonight, you have to sometimes really learn how to let go and recede and allow the creativity to flow as it needs to flow and not try and control how you think it needs to flow.
Right.
You know? So, Lisa and Zahra, they were right. You know? And so a whole different sort of magic, you know, emerged because they said no. No. And then.
Well, he didn't say it like yes, that.
And then we had to, we had to say yes. And there's a yes, saying yes is a big thing, because yes opens up the energetic and creative field. And so, so for me, it's not just tonight, but in general, I think it's always one of the lessons I'm learning, and is about how to let go and receive. And to receive, in order to receive fully, you have to say yes. They said, yes, that's nice, but no, let's not do it that particular way. So we had to say, yes, you're right. And it was beautiful.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Everybody was in agreement. So you had a flow.
Y'all did say it like that.
No. I'm not going to even get in the middle of that.
I was here, but... I'm gonna leave that alone. Did you have another question?
To add or say anything.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because what I learned about us and myself and tonight is this long continuum, especially, I played with Hamid, played with Josh. I mean, there's a lot of familiarity, but in this setting, I remember when they were in the beginning during our sound check, when we were setting up everything, and I finally got a glance at everything, and it was just like, oh, this is going to be great. I didn't know what it was going to be yet, or how it was going to start or end, or whatever, but it was like, all right, this is already something happening here. There's energetic fields already being set up, and in general, when I'm in the middle of something, I'm not, these questions are difficult because they're not, what's going on, at least while it's happening, is like not a verbal thing so much. And it's difficult to put in those contexts. But I've also found that, the music, the visuals, the everything as a whole, you realize you're a part of it, the whole. And especially tonight, I felt it very strongly that we each had our own parts. And those parts all came together and flowed together to make a whole. Just for me, I go back years ago, I used to write a lot of music for dancers and choreographers. And the one thing that always struck me was that, for instance, if you have a piece of music that's a great piece of music and it's finished and you can just listen to that music and go, wow, that's great music, why would you put that on top of a dance? Then it would be too much, right? There has to be something that you pull out of that music in collaboration with the other artists, so that what the two of you are doing makes the whole. Mm-hmm. Not each one of you individually making something that's complete in and of itself. And so that's how I always feel with these improvised situations, where we each have a part, and we are each putting in a part, and we're making a whole, and that whole has an energetic feel to it, and a sonic feel to it, and a visual feel to it, and if it's successful, in whatever way you want to talk about that, everyone did that. No one was pushing it over here or pulling it this way or saying, it's going on too long, this section, or whatever. Everyone just went with it.
Stayed in the moment.
And stayed in the moment and went with it, found its place. Moment to moment.
Mm-hmm.
That's Zahra's thing. Moment to moment.
Yeah, totally.
So that was my thing from tonight and in general.
Were you passing it this way?
I think one of the things that I discovered was I love working with my hands while through the process, because then I'm not like thinking, is this the time for me to come in, or is it, it's just like being fully present, like I feel like coming in right now. I feel like stopping. I feel like cutting while I'm singing, or standing still, or just and not focusing on whether might be the right thing to do in the moment, and it just was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was palpable what you were doing, mm-hmm. even when you were not making sound, yeah. even when you were just, you know, cutting paper or something. It was like there was an activity going on that was continuous. You really, I felt it all the way through.
Very organic.
Yeah.
Is that the dance?
Yeah.
It was very organic and very, you had a nice flow to what everything you were doing. And it seemed like you were very comfortable, like you're at home, and you just,
right.
you know, yeah, it felt like that. It was very natural. Yeah,
on the veranda.
Beautiful.
Right.
Did you want to pass the question along? Or did everybody get a chance to?
Yeah, we're all.
But
yeah.
I would like to know what since you kind of choreographed this, the whole, you know, you brought us together and everything, what you felt?
Yeah, great question.
Mm. Because if we spent a little over a year and a half having all these Zoom meetings and you were asking these questions, and, you know, we were all asking questions of each other also, but, you know, this was kind of like your brainstorm, you know, so,
mm-hmm.
so
mm-hmm.
now we've reached this particular portion.
Well, there was a part of me that definitely felt like I was on a journey with all of you. And then there was also a part of me that felt a tension as a researcher. And I think as researchers, we learn to observe and then to record our observations through writing. And I didn't feel like writing was appropriate at this moment in time. And I was thinking forward to, like, okay, when I go back and reflect on this, will I write up, right, what researchers talk about as field notes? And in my mind, I remember having the thought, like, I still don't think that's appropriate because there's something happening here that is beyond the written form. And as a researcher, I might need to learn a new way of processing and reflecting on the information. I also do work that people talk about as video ethnography, and I spend a lot of time looking at the moment-to-moment of interaction, and we focus a lot on talk. And partly what I noticed tonight as I was observing and watching and witnessing is really the importance of smiling. Like, there are moments when each of you were smiling and kind of, I think, just radiating love for what you're doing, love for one another,
mm-hmm.
and it, I think, coordinated and sometimes with shifts in the performance, and that's very different than looking at shifts in participation by solely focusing on talk. And so, you know, if I take that out to the classroom, then as a teacher, I might be asking myself, do I notice young people smiling? Mm-hmm. Not only at me, but with one another. And there are lots of thoughts I had like that along the way. I also noticed that there were many moments when people had their eyes closed. You all had your eyes closed. But you were still creating something together.
Mm-hmm.
And that's also very different than I think what we do in educational spaces, when we ask people to look at each other or look at the front of a space or the front of the room.
That's interesting you said as a writer. So Bill, can I ask you a question since you're there? Bill, why does he write for, you know, Music for the Reader and many other magazines and stuff? So is your experience similar? Like when you come to a concert and you go to see it and you probably have to write about it, is it similar to what Ananda was saying? I mean, is it a different time process for you?
Ha ha ha.
So I had one more question. I was writing while you guys were playing. And yeah, I was like caught in a moment and I started to reflect and write a few things down. So I wrote a few questions and I'll just give you one, because one of them actually was, how do we follow, how did you follow, oh, let me get my question together. How did the following, how did the following people influence your approach to your instrument and the way you play? And you guys kind of like talked about that, and I was going to go down the list of Fred Anderson, Pharoah Sanders, Yusuf Lateef, Don Cherry, Rashawn Roland Kirk, Wilbur Ware, and Jimmy Garrison. And I think you guys kind of covered that in your origin story, so I'll leave that be.
Well, I can say something about Don Cherry,
yes,
and Fred Anderson, and Pharoah Sanders.
Okay.
I mean, I toured with Pharoah Sanders for about 6 years, and I can say without a doubt, every day being with Pharoah was a learning experience. You know, we didn't talk much about music, you know, but just being in his presence and how this the whole creative process just exuded through him. You know, you look into those big eyes, you know, and his sound. You know, he was, I think, a demonstration, a living, walking, breathing demonstration of the whole creative process. He was open, you can ask him any questions or whatnot, but just it was the vibration that he carried that spoke, you know, and he was gifted with, I mean, the divine gave him so much, you know, and it came through his music, it came through the way he walked, and, you know, that Southern Arkansas voice that he had. Speak. He came through that. Don Cherry was the same in many ways. And in fact, my other daughter, Shanti's up there, also my granddaughter, Anaya. Ananda, Shanti, myself, their mother, and a dear friend, Adam Rudolph. We moved to Sweden in 1978, and we lived with Don Cherry's family. Ananda had her second birthday there. Shanti was 6 months. And Don Cherry was another person who creativity just moved, you know, through him. I mean, he saw the song in everything, you know, in everything. And he was probably one of the most naturally creative people that I had the chance, you know, to be around. But there was another quality about Don also, and there were three things he strongly believed in, and one was compassion, you know, the other was loving kindness, you know, and then having an open heart, you know, and he treated everyone the same, you know. He didn't see himself as, I'm Don Cherry, you know, the great trumpet player, you know, blah, 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 working with Warren Coleman, you know, and Sonny Rollins and all of that. No. He saw something interesting and beautiful in every being that he came in contact with. You know, and I had a very interesting experience with him, like one of the first concerts we did after we left Sweden. You know, it was in France, and after that we were going to do a small tour, then we were going to return back to Chicago. We're doing this piece we had worked on, and Don had given us this figure to play at the end of the piece three times, and then we would all stop together. And so playing this rhythm, he sings like, he called it, it's what they have in Indian music, a tihi. You do something three times and you stop. So he sang the pattern, everybody stopped except me. I was still playing. And so then he brought it back in again, and we stopped. But after the concert, his compassion was overwhelming, because he said, hey, Hamid, he said, I see you like to kind of go in a trance when you play something. He said, that's good. That's really good. But he said, also, sometimes it's good to be aware. You know? He didn't say, man, you messed up, and you nothing like that. You know, but in a loving, compassionate way. You know, and so he allowed me not to feel like with shame and blame, you know,
wow.
Which was really extraordinary. Mm-hmm. And I think all of us here can speak about Fred Anderson. You know?
Yeah.
It's like he was our Baba, you know.
Our
you
friend.
Know, he was our friend. He was our teacher. You know, he was the owner of a venue, you know, that so Chicago musicians, you know, of all ages could come and play and develop their thing, you know. I think everyone could talk about him as much as I can. You know?
Right.
So when he made his transition, you know, there was a vacuum. That was created. Thankfully, this space, Constellation, I think helped to fill that void. You know?
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, when you walk in, right over the bar, there's a big picture of Fred Anderson. You know? So,
yeah.
I mean, we can talk about him, you know, for long, 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 long time. You know,
Michael, were you
going to
say something?
No.
Okay.
So, but also I have to say something about Chicago, too, because Chicago is, Fred also is from Louisiana, same town I was from. He was born before me, of course, but his family moved to Chicago. He's from Monroe, Louisiana, same town. But Chicago, I think, is the basket, it's like a basket. This is of creativity. You know, every place I go, I travel a lot, everyone talks about Chicago. You know? And there's something different here than like New York or St. Louis or even Detroit or even New Orleans, you know, or even Houston. You know, I mean, you're from Texas, you know.
Yeah.
But there's something about Chicago, maybe because it's in the Midwest, I don't know, maybe because it was a major stop with African Americans coming from the South, moving further up, a lot stopped in Chicago, maybe because of the immensity of the vibration of the indigenous people that were here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like a center of this vast field, vast energetic field of creativity.
Mm-hmm.
Josh came here from Philly, you know, to drink, you know, that wealth, that liquid wealth that's here in Chicago. So there's something special about Chicago.
Yeah, when I was in the eighth grade, I knew I was coming to Chicago because I was studying with Charlie Parker and then just studying jazz, and I was like, man, I want to go on the path of jazz. So I gotta go to school. When I go to school, I'm gonna go to school. I studied with Alvin Batiste, so I went down to like New Orleans and that area. I was like, the next stop is Chicago.
Yeah.
So I knew that when I was in the eighth grade that I was coming to Chicago. Then I knew I had to go to New York. Then I knew I had to go to that's a port town, port city. So I knew I had to go to see the rest of the world from there. And I was able to do that. So in my mind, I was successful.
Yeah.
And following the path of jazz, but Chicago was definitely the first place, and it's for all those reasons that you said.
And not just
you know.
For the music, but for many things.
Yeah.
Many aspects of the arts.
Yeah, it's the energy that's here. But the actual question, now I think we probably got to go, because I don't know if we do or not, but the question that you guys can think about this, and or you can answer it now if you like, or somebody can answer it. But the one thing that came to me, I say, was when you were playing an ensemble, when you guys were all playing an ensemble, what were you in search of?
Mm-hmm.
And as it relates to rhythm, resonance, mm-hmm. and sound. And you could choose any one of them, or we can just sit here and think about that.
I was trying to say earlier, it's so difficult to say what I was thinking or what we were thinking while we were doing it.
Mm-hmm.
Now we can reflect and say, oh, yeah, we were probably thinking about this or that, but who knows? You know?
Cause
it's because it's... It, it's something where when you're in the midst of it, it's through you and all around you. So it's not something that I, you know, personally I can say, oh, this is, I mean, I know there are, you know, we can get into the micro things. Okay, we played this one rhythm at one point that was interesting that we just kind of hit.
Mm-hmm.
All right. But that in and of itself is like, that's a very small thing in the bigger fabric, you know, the fact that we do that or that we did that in this case or certain things happened at the same time. I don't think anyone was thinking that.
No.
You know?
Like Fred used to say, you don't have time to think. That's what Fred used to tell me that all the time. You ain't got time to think.
Yeah, I don't know. For me, it's always hard for me to answer a question like that. What were you thinking? Or what was the group thinking? Or what was...
It wasn't necessarily what you were thinking. Did I say thinking?
No.
Searching. Yeah, like what you were searching. Because I noticed at certain times, like Joshua would play something that in his bass line that propelled what was happening in the situation. And then sometimes I noticed that, you know, you may have recognized that and then played something that was complementary to that, and you guys stayed in that you know, it propelled like that. But then it will relax or something like that, and then someone else will take over the I guess whatever the energy that everybody was relating to, and you guys would just look around. That was the moments when they smiled or somebody smiled. It was like, yeah, and then you would go into another zone or something like that. But what I was feeling from the audience was the push and pull of energy. That's what I was kind of feeling. Like sometimes it would go idle and you know, meander out a little bit, but then sometimes it would go forward. And it would push, and it was all based off of one slight change in the way you were playing your rhythm up against, you know, and yeah, when you put out the two darbukas, I've never seen that actually. I've seen a cat play a darbuka like one, but like two at the same time. Me being a musician, I knew that you guys were in that moment crossing cultures. It was a lot of, but there were some universal rhythms that were being used that made it all fit, you know. Because I know you were playing like some of the rhythms and the style and the technique that you were playing was in on the top of like the Indian style, frame drum, yes. And you were playing the darbuka and these are two different cultures. And then you would come in with something of a bass line, and then she would come in with this soulful Louisiana Mississippi thing. And then Lisa came in with this drone. It was like, I was like, man, there's so much stuff happening right now. You know, it was, but if you just think about it, when I was thinking about it, I was like, yeah, I could go into this style and this style and this style, but it seemed like it was all one mesh of energy, and to me it was either going, like I said, it was either pushing or laying back, and you guys were like just changing slightly, slight things you were changing to make that happen.
You mentioned a very interesting word, meandering.
Yeah.
The meandering is the search.
You know? Yeah.
And when we're there, we're not searching, we're there, it is as it is, we're in the moment, and it's the flow, and it's not us, you know, searching for nothing, because we're there,
mm-hmm.
like, and whatever we want to call it. But the meandering is kind of the search.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think also that's the space where trust lives.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, and in that moment, the trust is no expectation, just be,
mm-hmm.
be there,
yes.
and see what the unveiling is going to bring. You know, and something else shows up, but it's about like not trying to push it or impose like the restless energy of are we on this too long or whatever, or you know, is there a destination we're going to? It's like the like I was talking about the scarab in ancient Egyptian culture means the act of becoming. So it never reaches.
beautiful. Mm-hmm. Well, searching for. It's like you're just trying to keep the current going, you know, to keep the flow happening. Just as a more general goal when we're all playing together. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because mm-hmm. it also, you can get, it, I mean, this is a different story, but I remember once playing with, there was a great, great, great piano player in town, Jody Christian. Play with him at the Velvet Lounge at Fran Anderson's establishment. And Jody would just, we'd play tunes, but he'd just go into it. He wouldn't call any tunes. Start to play the tune, go to another one. If you go anywhere. And, you know, that was challenging. So I remember one time playing, and it was like, oh, yeah, it sounded good. It was like I knew the tune, or I was able to figure it out. Yeah, this, and I started, and had this one thought really quick. Yeah, this is happening. You know, like, this sounds good. And he shot me the meanest look. Like, he'd be withering look. He was, and I, nothing changed in the music. He was like, you gotta stay focused. You don't have room to think this is good or bad. Or you gotta just play. So that was a great lesson. And yeah, that's great. That's the goal, to stay in it. I had no idea that I wasn't in it, but he was so attuned to everything that he couldn't even sense that you were maybe enjoying the music too much.
He's already taking his victory lap, right?
Right.
I think all the great masters were that way, from Nina Simone to Yusuf Lateef to mm-hmm.
But maybe that's something, sorry, maybe that's something that the music has the potential to do.
Well, I think it's that time of the night.
Yes.
Do you want to close us out?
Me?
Yeah. Or Zahra, would you like to close us out?
Fred.
I can close us out. Let's all give them one more round of applause for their time. Mr. Michael Zeranger. Mr. Joshua Abrams. Mr. Hamid Drake. Ms. Zahra Baker, Lisa Alvarez,
Alvarado,
and Ms. Lisa Alvarado. And Ms. yes,
Jackson,
thank you.
Ananda Marin.
Yes. Thank you for your energy and your time and your ears.
All right.
Good night.
Thanks, Nolan. Nolan up there in the box.
Yes, thank you for the sound.
You can always find yourself in music every night.
Man, that's such a heavy conversation. We could just keep talking.
Yeah, man, we could go on and go.
Yeah, man,
thank you,
Fred. Thank
you. Yeah, man, it's a pleasure to spend some time.
Oh, yes,
man.
Yes.
I hope we get to play some too.
I was thinking the same thing.
I would love that.
Yeah.